Carding Box, we lived a very special moment already many years ago in 2008, if I'm not mistaken, of your first visit to the Redman Library, and how the worlds of Sufism and Hermetism met. Can you tell something about it? It was the first time that you met my father.
And then later we organized that symposium together.
Yes.
With some other spiritual organizations. I have to say one thing, I'm not chairman of the Dutch Sufi movement, but one of the leaders of the international Sufi movement. It's a world movement. That is of course important. Now, when I had this first visit here in this wonderful library, I was just writing a new book about Sufism, and I started that book by quoting the Corpus Hermeticum, because Inayat Khan, the founder of the international Sufi movement, has always emphasized that Sufism is older than Islam. The source is really the old Hermetic wisdom in Egypt, the Corpus Hermeticum, it has been written down later, but it was a wisdom of mystics who came together in secrecy and so on, secrecy because the world around couldn't yet understand it. But they nurtured that deep wisdom that can be found in the core of our being, and from there it went to the Middle East in the time of Islam. And I found here in this library a book that described how this old Sufi made that trip from Alexandria to the Middle East. What was his name? Dulun. A very interesting figure. And he came in the world of Islam and began to explain his vision, his wisdom, which was embracing everything. It was so wide that some of the Islamic legal scholars and imams couldn't understand it. So he met opposition and he got into difficulties. So when he came, so then he was taken prisoner and brought to the court of the Caliph. But the story is that when he was brought there and the Caliph saw him, he was so impressed by the atmosphere of holiness that he radiated immediately. He was freed and kept there and lived there as a very honored guest to spread his wisdom, his vision of the truth. And what struck me so much that in some of these first statements of the Corpus Hermeticum, the essence is that there is one spirit that inspires the whole world, that is in everything, in all people, in nature, one spirit. And that's exactly what Hazrat Ibn al-Khan always says. He says that the best description of God is the only one, the only spirit. That is completely in line.
Yes.
Over that enormous period. So I described that in that book, in that first paragraph, and something about that story. And then I go on to describe how Inayat Khan, in a very simple and illuminating way, describes the being of man and what the human soul is, and how the soul is a kind of mirror in which the whole universe is reflected, and so on. And that it is so important that we learn to turn that mirror sometimes also around. It's mostly focused on the outer world, So the whole consciousness is filled by all that happens there, that comes to us and so on. That's an enormous thing. But so important that we learn also to turn it around so that it can reflect what is in the depths of our own being. And that is that one spirit that is within us. And then man can reflect the divine light and become conscious of the divine being. And that is, in a few words, the whole ideal of mysticism, that of course has been searched in so many different ways, and many different currents from that source of the Corpus Hermeticum have come about, Freemasonry and the Rosicrucians and so on. They all are looking for the realization of that inner truth.
Well, Joost Riepman, you have collected from the age of 16 a library of 30,000 testimonies of this understanding of the human being, of being a microcosm in which this divine light is reflected, and the way he is a mirror, not only of God but also of nature, and that the human being can know God in himself. You have been driven by this.
I can react to that, to also to continue what our brother here said. For me, God is the only one. He embraces the total creation, but he has also a symbol in the world, and for me that's the rose. The rose is for me the symbol of the divine element of life. And for me it was very clear when I was very young that there is that universal brotherhood of the rose, that millions around the world, that they carry that rose as a gift of God. And the gift of God is love. And that you have also to connect with all the aspects of life. So the soul is next to the body. For me, the personality, the person, is the instrument of communication, but the rose is a divine gift. And for me, this library is a testimony of all these brothers and sisters who represented since the last 5,000 years, when the initiation in Egypt arose, also in architecture, in divine wisdom, that for me, 5,000 years ago, around the world, there was an enormous impulse. And in Sufism, you find that also back in their candle, with the light candle with the seven sticks that are illuminated. And with a holy ceremony, you connect during your service the seven aspects. And for me, to say it in my words, you enlighten the power in the name of the Father. You connect it with the Son, and then you connect it with revelation, with the Holy Spirit. And at the moment that you have this threefold energy enlightened, it embraces four other candlesticks. And then in my words, it is the Corpus Christi, but not as a religion, but also as an energy field that is already intact in this world. You connect it also
with all these brotherhoods around the world, that they know at a certain moment that the Brotherhood of the Rose, what they produce is a perfume, a tincture, that you can absolutely, that you can inhale and that you can feel. And there's also another symbol for me in the way I was inspired to connect and to bring all these testimonies together, that the rose is a principle, but the principle of the rose is fire, is energy, is light. And therefore, for me, it is very clear that at a certain moment we come to a next development in the world, that this universal brotherhood of the rose, the seven fraternities, we say six fraternities in Sufism, and then the seventh candlestick were enlightened to embrace the world. And for me, I can say, with my brother here, I recognized you as a brother in that eternal chain. Mm. And for me, it was an absolute momentum that I knew that we are now in a momentum that we should connect also your ideal. And you said next year you will be 95, and next year I will be 75. Mm. But I only can say to you, I am very inspired by your living example as a human being.
Mm. Well, thank you very much. It is indeed this important to live, to try to live that spiritual ideal. That is a central idea of the Sufi message, that we search that inner truth, but we do not withdraw from the world, as many mystics have done, concentrate fully on meditation and so on in the woods, on the mountains. We still are in the world, in the midst of the world, and we unite the inner and the outer life. In the inner life, we turn within, we find that light, that inspiration, and from there we work in the outer world. And that is the ideal, because then your work outside in the world becomes more beneficent, because it's connected to the spirit of that only being.
Yeah, and it is so nice in the Corpus Medicum that it is said a man is a personality, and he has a soul, and he has to work with this principle, with the instrument of the soul. But the gift of the God, the gift of God is that he connects his spirit at a certain moment with your soul. And for me, the mystery of creation is that at the moment of creation, the Lord created also the world soul. The world soul. So the atmosphere that embraces already the whole world is already there. The only thing what we have to do is to discover that reality. Mm. And then to connect also the inner and the outer in our relationship with love to the world and all the aspects of life.
Well, you have established this year a foundation, and you're speaking about the world soul, but the name of this foundation in which you want to transfer the ownership of not only the Bibliotheca Filosofica Hermetica, but also a wonderful 17th century city palace called Huis met de Hoofden, House with the Heads, the future location of the library, that you want to transfer these into the World Heart Foundation. to create a place in this house where the library is placed in the heart of that house, but also from the World Heart Foundation, it will be a new task of the library to create a platform where all aspects of society, of science, art and spirituality will come together. It will become a dynamic meeting place for all kinds of people who want to add their knowledge and their wisdom to this platform and see how, according to the ideals of Comenius, Jan Amos Comenius, who lived there, how to improve the humanness of humanity.
Yeah, I can tell you the reason that I founded the World Heart Foundation is that in life you have three aspects of development. You have the formation of what exists in daily experience around you, but the real meaning of life is to connect the soul principle with the aspect of the Rosicrucian manifestos, that it needs also a reformation of the personality, and that he absolutely is aware that the soul principle, and I call that the Rose principle, has to be connected with the personality. And then you come to the third aspect, what I call transformation. And my library is a laboratory of transformation where you need persons, where you meet the soul principle, but that you connect yourself with that eternal principle of infinite fire. And for me, it starts with the spark, then it becomes fire, and fire is the principle of to take action, and then at a certain moment you have light. And for me, the Christ or the divine principle is taken into the world, that I am the light of the world, so that at a certain moment that also the Christ is saying the light principle will transform the world. And for me, the house with the head was founded almost 400 years ago, and there 400 years ago it started in the city of Amsterdam, that the people came together from all the cities, all the countries of Europe. They want to create a new world atmosphere. They call that democracy, or in a way, a modern development of human life. But it all started here in the city of Amsterdam.
Well, Karin Bax, we know, we just discussed that in the 17th century, this whole concept of Reformation that was brought into the world by the Rosicrucian manifestos, that one of the main sources of inspiration were the principle of Sufi order in Fes, the Brothers of Purity. And in the World Heart Foundation, in the house with the heads, we would like to establish, according to the ideals of Comenius, he said there should be an overarching principle, and that unites, in fact, all religious denominations, all aspects of the development of science, of art, of humanity. And he called that Pan Sophia, all wisdom. And he thought that Amsterdam might very well be the place where a collegium nuces, a sort of a wisdom council, would be established, where all the efforts to improve the humanness of humankind should be the responsibility of a world wisdom council. We think that the time has come where the house with the heads can become a platform for this kind of initiatives. We have invited you to be a member of this wisdom council, but what is the essential purpose? What connects us is how do we bring this into practice, and what is your vision of on what is needed to establish this new impulse in the world of today?
What is needed very much is to bring that connection with the divine light more into all the different human activities, into our culture. And that is so necessary because our culture had become very much materialized.
Yes.
Very much focused on material life and all our great achievements in science and technology and so on, while the old religious ideas lost some of their attraction, their inspiration, because they have become too rigid, so that the dogmatic approach of Christianity, for example, doesn't inspire people so much anymore. Of course, therefore the Christian churches also begin much more to look at the mystical aspect and meditation. And that is a beginning of Reformation, that's very important. But there is, therefore, in our society, very great lack of that spiritual inspiration. For example, in education, greatest importance, that children at that age, when they can absorb so easily the impressions they receive. Their children have not been told in any way about the unity of creation, the meaning of religion, the spiritual meaning of religion in life, spirituality, even the field of morality that we all have to do so much about is scarcely touched. It is here in the West almost completely directed to develop the capacities to work in society, to read and to count and all that, and language. That is the focus. And of course, we had Christian schools that were also meant to teach religion, but in most cases, that doesn't work so well anymore. So, in Uitgaan wrote already a century ago, it would be very important to bring spirituality into education. He even says, when that is not done, then the whole, every attempt of reformation will fail, because then people have not developed that openness to the spirit, and that can best develop when you are young. So if I may just add very briefly, I have been working in the past years to bring together mystics who touch that inner light in different ways, from Sufi orders, from other religions, together to focus on that. We found deep unity between us, from very different countries, different religious backgrounds, and we have now focused in that meeting on the importance of spirituality and moral values in education. And we were completely agreed on that. And I published a concluding statement that fits very well, I think, in what you aim here. And therefore, I'm certainly very happy to, if I can contribute anything to this Wisdom Council. We must not expect too much. Years ago, I have been a member of an international Wisdom Council, also by scientists, were there, extremely interesting. But it took too much time for me, and also what I missed there was the idea of the one spirit in society and all the sciences. That they were groping for it.
Yeah, but
the idea of God was rejected.
Yeah, but I have always a feeling of victory during my life, as I know that the fire that is enlightening the world, you don't can distinguish, you don't can destroy that energy.
Yeah, that's always there.
And therefore, I take the example of a human being. A human being is the candlestick. And if he's really, I would say, taken into that union of the spirit, the divine spark becomes at the top of the candlestick, the head of a human being, becomes a working power field. And for me, the feeling of victory that I have, that we are sitting in a chain together of brothers and sisters in a community that I give also a certain number, 5,000 years. But I know that fraternity will continue even in the moment if we are no longer here. And that is the testimony of my library, that my library is a library of the Hermetic tradition, where the Creator is, for me, the starting point. Creation is His present, and man is, I would say, the instrument of awareness. And when we awake that awareness in ourselves and around us, then we transform the world. And that is, for me, the destiny of the World Heart Foundation in the house with the heads.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm really very, very pleased that in this one spirit, we now live an actual birth moment of this this wisdom principle that you radiate from your own presence in what you represent. So thank you very much.
Very happy to have been here in this wonderful surrounding again. May the wisdom spread.
Yes.
So is it.